Hello, class. Welcome to the very last tutorial for 3D Comp. It's hard to believe, but here it is. So what we're going to be talking about today is more advanced matinee functions. So how are we going to be controlling lighting and animating lighting through matinee? We're going to do some animation, we're going to do some particle effects, and I think we're going to throw in sound as well. And maybe at the very end, if the video is short enough, maybe do some camera effects. And if we don't get the time to do the camera effects, there's actually a nice article on Epic's forums which go over controlling those through matinee. So let's get started. Last week we added a matinee track. We did a couple of things. We added two cameras, and we animated those two to fly through our level. And then we added a director group, which took care of switching between what we were viewing from one camera to the next. And we were also adding a fade track, which would fade in, fade out. So the next thing we're going to be looking at is adding in animation. So what I want to do is first deselect my direct group camera view. I don't want to be messing around with that for the time being. So right now I'm just going to be looking for my asset. Now, I might have done this off-screen, I don't remember, but if we look at this asset, what it is Walker Animated, and it's basically, it's just my skeletal mesh. When you import your characters, your walkers rather, you will be presented with two options. And if you drag one in the scene, one will be animated, and if you drag another in the scene, it won't. This one is the one that's not animated. This is Walker Animated, is what I called it. But this is just the skeletal mesh. This contains the mesh and the skeleton properties, but no animation data in it. If you look at the other one, which is the animation sequence, which is, I should have not included animated, because what it says is Walker Animated Anim. And Anim stands for animation sequence. So this one contains the animation sequence in it. And what it'll do by default is loop. So if you have something in your scene that's just going to be repeating the same animation over and over and over, and it has a skeletal mesh to it, what you could do is use this function. You can use this anim actor. But in our purposes, we're going to be doing a couple things with adjusting animations within matinee. So if you had a couple of animations, you can mix and match between those in matinee. And instead of just looping one, we're going to go into more complex detail, essentially. So, oh, that's right. So if you're in matinee, you can't actually delete things, but you can add things. So I just exited out of matinee and deleted that real quick. So once again, I want to get out of my director group, and I want to find my skeletal mesh. And the next thing I want to do is add a group which will affect this skeletal mesh. So I can do that quite easily. I just come over here to the blank space. I can right-click. And if you haven't guessed it already, the one that we want is new skeletal group. I'm going to call this Walker. And you'll see that you're presented with two tracks. Oh, and something I should mention, if you don't have your asset selected before you create this group, it won't be connected one to the other. What you can do is actually, after you've created one of these and you hadn't had this selected, you can add the actor through here. But I've had more trouble doing that than creating it originally with it selected. So when you create this new skeletal mesh, or skeletal animation group, make sure to have your walker selected. It'll save yourself a lot of hassle. So we'll look at this, and we have two tracks now. We have one for movement, which is pretty much exactly the same as the camera. So if you wanted to, you could animate your walkers to move from, I don't know, one side of the room to the other. If you have a walker that's floating, so if you have one of those, what you could do is animate it to like bob up and down, if that's not already in your idle animation. But we're going to be doing mostly just playing around with the animations that we exported from Maya. So to add one of those, it's pretty simple. all we have to do, I'm going to full screen this real quick, is I'm going to come to the very beginning of my sequence. I'm going to hit enter, and I'll present it with an iAnimation sequence. So I can just click that real quick. Pull this down again. And we can see now it plays. It's really not that hard. I mean, if you were to jump in this, you know, right away, it would be a little more difficult. But once you get a sense of how these tools work together, it's really not that hard. So I'd like to show you guys something real quick about exporting different animations, because I don't think I got into that. And that's something I never learned at Columbia, which held me back for a while. So when you're creating characters for a game, what you're doing is saving out many different many different scenes, Maya scenes, which contain separated animation information. So what some people do is they'll create one really big scene that has all their animation in the same timeline. And then what they'll do is save that separately for each individual animation in that sequence and delete all the keys that don't correspond with that animation. So that seems a little complicated, but let me bring up my example, and I can show you more about what I'm talking about. So we're in the Walker export. So I'm going to be doing this more quickly. In this instance, I already have my skeleton that's animated. All the keys are baked in already. So this is more of a janky way of doing it, but you should get the idea. So what I'd normally do is have the rig and everything in place. We'll do it this way. So say you have exactly what I have, which is your animation sequence all done, and everything's animated and baked. But you want to separate some of your animations. So I have two here. If we remember those animation videos, I did this one right here, where he looks down and looks back up. And then I have this one, which is separate, where he bobs up and down a couple times and then stamps his feet. So say I want these two animation sequences to be separate from each other so I can control them in UE4. Well, I can absolutely do that. And the way we do that is first we need to find the very first frame in this animation sequence. I don't exactly remember what it is. I think it's around 90? Yeah, let's go with 90. So I want everything before 90 to be deleted. I'm just going to cut that real quick. And I want everything starting from 91 to be all the way at the beginning of my sequence. A little touchy, but there we go. Whoops. if you haven't already guessed it, what I did is I just adjusted one of these bones. I have to do the whole thing. So select the whole group of bones, and we'll do that again. So I'm going to take from 90 back, cut that, haul this forward, and bring it back. All right, so now my new animation sequence ends at 79. So I can just type in 79, enter, and there we go. If I play it through once, we can make sure that, yeah, okay, so it's a little janky at the loop, but I'm not going to let that bother me. We're just going to export this. So I've just created a different animation sequence by breaking up that one. If I had like three or four, I'd save it out each time. I'd do it three or four times and just break up the animation. That's my workflow. That's how I work from time to time. And then what we can do is actually export just the animation, the bones from this, so that we can bring that into our skeletal mesh in UE4 and use that as a second animation sequence. So what I'm going to do first is grab my bones, and I have to grab all of them once again. And instead of selecting my mesh also, all I have to do is go into File, Export Selection, FPX, yes, that's what I want. And I'm going to go into Export. I'm going to do second loop typing with one hand is difficult. Sec loop. Close enough. All right, so I'm going to be including animation. I'm not going to rebake this. It's going to go from the time slider, so from 1 to 79 in this case. That's how Maya works. And up axis Z, basically I want to make sure that all these correspond to the same export settings that I set with my original skeletal mesh. So now I can export this. And I'm going to close out of Maya. Normally I would save this as a separate scene, but in this case I don't need it. And I'm just going to come back into UE4. And now I'm going to bring up my Explorer so I can find that file, 3D comp, classwork. I should really make shortcuts. There we go. So now I have my second loop. So what I can do is just drag and drop it. And then I'll be... Oh, you know what? I have Matinee open. That might be screwing with things. Let's try that again. All right, we'll do it the old-fashioned way. Sometimes I find that dragging and dropping doesn't always work. Your miles may vary. So now I can see that I'm given the normal FBX import options. But this time, instead of making a new skeleton for this, what I can do is select it, and I can find two skeletons in here. One is the Hero TPP skeleton. That's the one that's included with the content examples, or when you're creating a new scene and you select the standard 3D, whatever. It's not ours. What we want is the Walker animated skeleton. So we'll select that one. And yes, we want to export time, import custom attributes. Yeah, that doesn't really apply to us, but I'll leave it checked on just in case. And everything else should be fine. So I'm just going to hit import all. And wow, look at that. It even included the mesh. How cool are they? So I can double click on this now and just see that now it is my cut down animation. So this is my separated animation sequence. Super simple. And now we can have more control over our skeletal mesh in UE4. So let's check that out real quick. So I'm going to go into my Matinee editor. And I will full screen this real quick. And now I want to go under my animation track. And I'm going to come off a little bit to the side, hit enter. And I can see now I have my second loop. I can add that in. So what I want to do is basically have it so he just does that weird head bobbing thing once. And then this second loop is what repeats over and over. So I'm going to turn on snapping because I think that might help. I haven't had much luck with snapping. I'm just going to get this as close as I can. So I'm doing this by holding down control and left dragging. And that looks pretty close. So I can come down here and take a look at what's going on now. So yeah, there's some bobbing up and down. If you spent more time selecting your keys carefully, you wouldn't be having this problem. So what happens is this second loop kind of just ends, and then the animation stops, and now it's just still. That's not necessarily what I want. So what I really want is for this sequence to loop over and over and over. So there's actually a function in Matinee that'll do that for us automatically. We don't have to copy and paste this a bunch of times. The way we do it is we hold down control and select our loop. And then, what is it? I'm having a mouse malfunction. And then loop sequence. Oh, I'm sorry. That's not right. Okay. I just had a brain malfunction, more like it. So instead of right-clicking on the blue part, we have to right-click on this tiny little arrow, so don't miss that. And then what we do is want to set looping. And what that does is fill in the rest of the sequence with the looping. And that's perfect. Of course, there's that little hitch in the, between our frames, and that's not exactly pretty, but this will be fine for us for now. All right, so now we have our animation. Still a bit of a goofy animation. That's too bad that loop happens to be right when the camera's right over it, but whatever. I'm not going to worry about it right now. So the next thing we want to add is, you know what? Why don't we do some particles? Wouldn't that be cool? So let's find... Let's see what, blah, 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 blah. I'm talking too fast today. Let's see what we can find in the starter content. So I'm going to click on that real quick, and I'm going to find the particles folder, and perfect. P underscore smoke. I'm going to drag and drop that into the level right away. What I can see is now I have the smoke system, and I guess I'm just going to add this somewhere on, maybe in these bins. I'll do that. That looks kind of cool. Go to the other side too. This is the environmentally unfriendly walker. I like it. Alright, so what I'm going to do next is I'm going to grab my particle system, which is up here. I'm going to drag this down so I can see more of what's in my scene. And I think what I want to do is just drag and drop P-Smoke right into my walker. And the UE4 is smart enough to know that the walker has many different bones on it. So this is really, really cool. And I actually haven't discovered this until literally just now. So instead of going into the skeletal mesh, assigning a socket, and then creating a blueprint, and then assigning the particle system the blueprint, you can literally just grab a particle system, drag and drop it into Walker Animated, and choose a socket or bone from here. Man, is that cool. So let's say I want to do the main root, and I want to do the same with the second one. Main root. And it looks like they're not offset, so I think I have to offset those myself. So it looks like it snapped it straight to the root, which is not necessarily what I want. This is such a cool feature anyways. I can deal with having to place these twice, so long as it just stays in place. All right. So let's see. Oh, how cool is that? It's a little weird because the smoke follows the system. So what you'd probably want to do is recreate this with blueprints. But I like it. I think it's charming. So I'm just going to leave it like this for now. So what you could normally do is, instead of attaching a whole particle system, what you could do is attach the emitter so that you would... Yeah. So basically what you're trying to do is get it so not all the smoke follows with. I'm not exactly sure how to do that. I know there's a simpler way to do it, but I'm not going to get into it right now. So the smoke moves with him. A little weird, but that's fine for now. So that was pretty cool. But we haven't really added these to Matinee yet. It's not doing anything specific. So when we hit play, particle systems just ramp up and they go real quick. So it looks really distracting when the smoke follows the walker when he does this thing. So what I want to do is kind of get the smoke going kind of maybe right about here. Once that animation sequence is ended, I'll start it here. So how do we do that exactly? Same thing as before. First we have to make sure that our particle systems, our emitters are selected. I can do that by selecting them here. And now I want to right click and I want to add new particle group. And I'm going to call this smoke. All right, so now I get a new sequence called toggle. our new track, rather, called Toggle. So this is exactly what it sounds like. If I hit enter, I want to toggle this on. Hit OK. And that should be all I need. You know what? Actually, there's one more thing I need, but let's see if you guys can figure it out as we do this. Let's see what the problem is. I'm going to hit play real quick. Maybe I should start it at the beginning so I have a new... There we go. You know what? Actually, I'll just close it from here and we'll play. So it looks like the particle system already was created. And that's a bit of a problem for us. So how do we fix that? Well, what's happening is when these smoke particle systems are being brought into the world, just like everything else standard in UE4, they are auto-activated. So we have to select each one of these and turn that off. So now if we hit play, we'll see that they're not auto-activated, so they'll be waiting for the prompt to activate, and that's right about now. Cool. So that's all pretty easy. What else can we add? Sparks. What does sparks look like? That's a little too much. Ambient dust. Maybe I'll add ambient dust just to have pretty dust anyways. Oh, that does not work. Oh, I know what we could do. So say it doesn't start smoking until something internal happens and there's an explosion, and then it starts smoking bad. Well, let's do that. We'll add an explosion. And I'm going to do what I did before and attach this explosion straight into the walker root. I'm going to pull it back somewhere near the end. I want to make sure I turn off auto activate. And I want to go back into my matinee. Open matinee. And I will create, do I still have it selected? Yeah. I will create a new group. Yeah, because I don't think what I think I could add this explosion to the group, but I think this toggle acts globally across the entire group. So I'm going to add a new group. With explosion selected. New particle group. Explosion. There's probably a way to have these on the same in the same group, but toggle them separately. But we're going to keep it separated. Anyways, so let's find a point when we want this explosion to happen. So probably right before the smoke. So I'm going to click right about here. Make sure I have the toggle on my explosion, explode 9 gen on, and I want to do trigger, switch that to on. We'll hit play. Cool, let's hit G and see what that looks like without. Cool. You can see that my particle system is actually already on. And that's because we toggled it on. So what we can do to make sure that this doesn't happen again, I'm going to come under here in the smoke toggle, and I'm going to add a key at the very beginning that's called trigger off. And what this will assure is that the particle system is off when we play. That seems to just be on anyways. Could just be a weird thing. So let's hit play and see what happens. Yeah, so it's still off, which is good. Let's see if we find that explosion come through. Cool. I was not expecting that. It worked the first time. That never happens. All right, so... you'll imagine something about this explosion that's missing, and that's the explosion sound. Fortunately, we have that right here in audio. Let's see, explosion. Let me make sure I have my headphones plugged in so I can actually hear it. But I'll be hearing myself, which is kind of weird. All right. So we need explosion. There's one and two. Let's find what the first one sounds like. So this is a sound cube. What's happening here is it's grabbing both of these wave files, this explosion one, explosion two, and it's selecting a random value. So it's basically saying, I don't know what it'll be, this or this. Let's find out. Something. Plug it in. Modulator is just a way to change pitch and volume and stuff. And then this is the output node that's literally just throwing it out there. So this is much better than using just one explosion sound, because maybe someone would recognize hearing the same explosion more than once. So I'm going to grab the sound cue, the explosion cue, and I'm going to drag and drop that into my scene. I'm going to hit the G key to make sure that I'm out of game mode and I can actually see what I'm doing. And you can see that there is some weird circles going on here, right? So what this is basically telling us how loud the sound is going to be within these circles. If we look under sound, I haven't played with much of the sound mixing and stuff yet, but essentially what it is within this inner circle, you'll be hearing the explosion within full volume. And the farther out you go, the less it'll be until you reach the outside of this circle, and then you won't hear it at all. So let's go ahead and make sure that we have a new group that controls this activation. First, we want to make sure auto activate is off once again. And we'll go under matinee. And I am going to close these up. And I am going to right doing that. I think I deselected my sound. Right click, add new. I guess they don't have a sound group. That's okay, we'll just do a new empty group. And we'll call this sounds. All right, and next thing we want to do is add a soundtrack. And, you know, I haven't tried this yet, so hopefully it's just as easy as doing that. And let's find where that explosion happens. That is right there. Hit enter. Explosion cue. Perfect. So I'm going to stop and I'm going to hit play. It's kind of weird that it doesn't have any other sounds. So sounds like that's a little late. So I'll have to go into the matinee actor. Ah, yes, you can see that it is a fraction of a second late. And sometimes that's what you want, sometimes it's not. And it's also a little bit quiet, so what I think I'm going to do is grab this element here, sound cue. You can't scale it like you used to. Well, maybe I'll just turn up the volume multiplier to 1.2, just so it's a little bit louder. All right, so let's try that again. It sounds like what's happening is that this explosion cue is playing the audio a little bit late, so we'll have to play it earlier than the actual event. So let's see. Interesting. Oops. What am I doing? Interesting. That doesn't seem to be changing it. Perhaps what it is looking for is the actual explosion particle system to be emitted. I've never seen that before, but you know what? We'll just leave it as it is. So maybe we can add some ambient sound. Let's see if we can find something that's nice. What's our starter pack music cue sound like? No, that seems a little irritating. Starter wind. Let's hit play. So it sounds like it's going to be applied globally. You can see that this starter cue doesn't have like that circle that was presented to us with the last one. So what that means is it's playing across the entire level. But I'm going to find the volume and I'm going to bring that down quite a bit. Man, I wish that volume was louder. Let's see, maybe if I just bring this back a little bit, we can hear it a little better. I can't hear it at all. I don't know what's happening with this audio cue. You know what I think I'll do? I think I'm gonna delete this one. I'm going to create my own explosion sound. I'm going to right click on this one, create cue, and I'm going to drag that, leave it right here. And so this is how you would control how large the object is and how far away you would hear. But I'm just going to have this play across the entire level so we can hear it well. But I have to make sure that I set this up in Matinee, so I'll go into Matinee. I'll clear out of this sound cue and make sure I'm not in my director group. Find this audio. That's the starter wind. Explosion. And we'll add a new empty group. Explosion. And I'm gonna add a new soundtrack. And I'm gonna hit enter. Q1. I think that'll work much nicer for us. But it's definitely a little too early now. So, it's working now. I think what it was is that custom pre-made sound cue I was playing. It's just too complex sequence. So I want to make sure that I add a little bit of a delay for the sound to have its time to travel across the distance. It's a little too long. About half of what I've got now. All right, that should be good. So I want to make sure that the sound cue is a little bit lower than it is. And I have to make sure that auto activate is turned off, so it doesn't just explode straight when we start the scene. Yeah, I like it. Doesn't sound like this other loop, this wind loop, is actually looping. Where is this? Started when you keep finding content browser. This one. Okay. And I thought there was a loop looping. So I just did that just like adding any other node. Right click, search for loop. There it is. Plug it straight in. Should be good for us now. Bit of a jitter there, but once again, I'm not going for perfect, because we'd be here all day. We're getting about just about to the end, so I think I'm going to add one more thing. I think what I want to add is a light to show off this explosion a little bit more. So if we take a look at it right now, there's a little bit of light that's emitted, but I kind of want to accent that and make it a lot more visible. So I'm going to grab a new light, and I'm going to drag it right here. And I'll change the color to something fiery red. I'll make the intensity really bright. Just to kind of see what it'll look like when it explodes. And I'm going to make it movable, make sure it's dynamic for my system. So let's go into Matinee once more with my light selected, right click, add new lighting group, and we'll call this X Blow. Light. Explodes light. Man, I cannot type with one hand. All right, so this is going to be doing the same thing as before, where it's controlling certain attributes. In this case, we have intensity, movement, light color, radius, and you can add quite a few more, I believe. Maybe not. Maybe there's not too many. Well, these will be fine for us. So really all we want to do is be able to control the intensities. We want to make it flash. So what I can do is I can find where my explosion is, which is this key right here. So under my intensity, I'll set a new one. And then I'm going to set a new one. So what this is doing for me is, actually, I think I have to create one more. So what this is saying is, at the very start, it's set at 0. I want it to flash up to its brightest point within, what is that, a third of a second, and then return back to 0. So the way I affect this is by right-clicking, oh, not set time, right-clicking and setting the value, And we're going to set the first one to 0. Set the last one to 0. And I'm going to find what intensity I set it at. Oh, I'm in my director group. I'm screwing things up. Stop. It was 10,000, so that should be fine then. Oh, because I was on that key, it actually... Well, that's cool. So you can actually set these values right here. So as long as you're on a key, you can move these around. So let's take a look. It looks pretty cool. I can go through it real slowly. And I can make this like something even really crazy, like I come under here and add a 0. So it's like a really big explosion. Yeah, it seems intense now. Maybe a little too intense. We'll bring that down a tiny little bit. So instead of adding a 0, I will subtract a 0, add a 5 at the beginning, and now we have half that value. Still pretty bright. We'll add a 2 this time. Yeah, and that'll probably be fine. And if we wanted to, we can play around with these a little bit to extend the length of that light. I think that looks pretty good. So something that you'd probably want in something like this is, mechanical sounds. If you were doing this for an actual level, you'd have to make sure that the first sound that you're doing is your character sound, because typically those are the most important. But because I don't have any recordings for this project, I have to suffer with having a quiet walker. So, yeah, I mean, that's pretty much it for Matinee. What we did through Matinee today was we animated our walker. In some cases, we might have even added a second animation sequence. We then added a particle system directly to one of the bones, which is really cool. And we made it toggle. We added a second one for explosions. We actually added a sound cue to correlate with our explosion. First, we had to create the sound cue, then we had it actually applied to the Matinee, and then we have finally our light. Okay, I know I said that we were going to try and do some camera animations, but unfortunately, I want to keep this video a little bit shorter. Let's see. There was a release recently on the UE4 learning page, Matinee Camera Effects. So if you click on this, it'll bring you up to a documentation page, and it'll talk about adding a new camera group, setting float property, camera component field of view, and all this other really cool functions like film contrast and all this really cool stuff. It's a little bit more involved. It would take you a little bit to get used to it, but it's a little bit out of our scope for this video. So what we have to do, the very last thing that we have to do, is record a video that we can play back. So this is actually pretty easy. Back in Unreal 3 days, it was a little bit more difficult. One thing you can do, you can absolutely do if you'd prefer, is if you have like an NVIDIA graphics card or desktop recording software or Fraps or any of those recording softwares, just play the level and record it straight from there. If you don't have that option or you don't want to pay for Fraps or something like that, you can actually do it within Matinee. So, the way we do this it seems really tempting, very, very tempting to hit the record button. But it is not actually what we want. What we want is the movie button. So if we click on that, you'll be prompted with some options for what kind of movie type you want to make. AVI is a pretty good standard. I would like you guys to do at least 720p. If your computers can handle it, please do 1080p. And set the frames per second for something, you know, standard. 30, maybe even like 24 for like a movie. I'll try 24. Turn on cinematic mode. That's fine. Disable this. All this stuff is fine. So I'm going to hit play. We'll see if this works. It takes a little bit to compile everything because it's basically making a copy of the game separate for this instance. And I'm also doing things like running Premiere in the background and other stuff. So we'll see if this actually works. Yeah, it's running a little slow, but that's okay. When it plays back, it should be at real time. So if your computer is really slow and it takes a while, Matinee is smart enough to render out the movie at the pace which would get you the actual frames which you'd need. So meaning if you have a computer that can't render this in 60 frames a second, if you set it to 60 frames a second, it'll render it video for 60 frames a second. It just won't actually render in that at that speed. So you can see now that it switches to the character blueprint, so I can walk around with the stock 3D guy. And you can do that too if you'd like. Record a little bit of yourself like actually running through the level. But when you want to stop, you can't actually just hit the stop button or anything like that. You have to hit the Schwinn key or whatever it's called to enter in a simple line of code, or script rather, that's stop movie capture. And it'll stop the capture, and you can actually find this video window and close out of it. So after you do that, you can go into your project settings, or your project directory. It's projects, Walker, saved. And just like there was before with the screen captures, we go to video captures, and here's mine. You see that it's a little choppy in the playback, probably because I have all this stuff running at once. Doesn't sound like it actually brought the sound over, which is somewhat alarming. So if you happen to have a problem like that, just send me an email. It might not have the ability to actually record sound through the Matinee, in which case I would recommend something like Fraps or the NVIDIA option. So yeah, that's a quick and dirty way of getting a video out. If you have any questions, always email me, whatever. I'll always be happy to answer. And if you have any specific questions about Matinee in general, please shoot those to me as fast as you can, and I'll get you going. All right, thanks guys.